If you've heard of the Kardashev Scale before, it's probably because you're a fan of science fiction. If you haven't heard of it, it is a way of classifying civilizations, especially those of an extraterrestrial nature, based on how much energy they consume. So it might sound like it came straight out of a Hollywood blockbuster, but the Kardashev Scale actually has some very serious scientific thought behind it. It's also more than just a guide in humanity's continuing search for extraterrestrial intelligence. This scale can help us predict the next steps in our own advancement, and even anticipate some of their side effects. It can even prompt us to ask some big questions, like what do we value, and what do we want to work towards long-term as a species? So let's take a journey through this scale that goes from a few blue whales at one end, to our potential intergalactic overlords at the other. We've had radio telescopes focused on the sky for more than 65 years now, and while most scientists think that we haven't spotted any alien civilizations in that time, or any alien individuals for that matter, it's still important to know what to look for. That's what Nikolai Kardashev was thinking about in 1964 when he created the scale that would eventually bear his name, or at least an anglicized version of his name. Kardashev figured that the more energy a civilization consumes, the easier it would be to detect its radio signals from our neck of the woods. So he defined a Type 1 civilization, that's a Roman numeral one, as using close to what humanity was using at the time, around 40 quintillion ergs per second. If you don't know what an erg is, I don't blame you for that, so let's convert that to something more familiar, 4 terawatts. We were only using 4 terawatts per second back then? Oh my god, that's adorable. Meanwhile, a Type 2 civilization would harness all the energy of its own star, which would be 100 trillion times more than a Type 1. And a Type 3 would harness all of the energy of its own galaxy, 100 billion times more than Type 2. Sounds simple enough, and perhaps a little too simple, because in the decades since, countless scientists have iterated, edited, and expanded upon Kardashev's original idea. Probably the most famous of these was Carl Sagan. In 1973, he swapped the Roman numerals for Arabic, and then created an equation that would let you calculate decimal values if your alien civilization fell somewhere in the middle, which it seems like it might. To craft that equation, he started by defining the energy that you'd plug in to get a final value of 1. 10 petawatts, also known as 10 to the 16 watts. While that number is somewhat arbitrary, it started a pattern where each step of the scale adds another 10 zeros to the number of total watts. In other words, a Type 2 civilization consumes 10 to the power of 26 watts, which is roughly the output of the sun, and a Type 3 is 10 to the power of 36 watts, which isn't too far off from the estimated energy output of the Milky Way galaxy. When Sagan devised this scale, if you added up all of the energy humans generated, we'd be sitting not at a Type 1, but a whopping Type 0.7. And if we can score a value less than 1, that means we can find out what a Type 0 civilization would be. If you extend the scale down to 10 to the power of 6 watts, you reach the level of biological power. In fact, based on their active metabolic rate alone, a pod of just 3 blue whales would qualify as a Type 0 civilization, which I love. That's great. Unfortunately, they're such solitary creatures that they normally don't team up for long periods of time. Scientists have also extended the Kardashev scale in the other direction, introducing a Type 4 civilization consuming 10 to the power of 46 watts. That's about 2 orders of magnitude off the energy of the entire observable universe. Some have even discussed the idea of a Type 5 civilization, which would have to harness the power of multiple universes. And if they can do it, I wish them well. But before we get too carried away, we should take a moment to state the obvious. This classification system is coming from the perspective of just one civilization that hasn't even made it to Type 1 yet. As of 2020, humanity is sitting somewhere around 0.7276 on the Kardashev scale. But it's hard to calculate all of the energy consumed by our civilization, so that's just one estimate floating around in the literature. The study that calculated that number also forecasts that we will reach 0.7449 by 2060. Meanwhile, other papers attempt to predict when we'll finally hit Type 1, providing guesses between 2333 and 2404. All of these guesses depend a lot on what the future holds for us. For example, if we figure out how to generate power through nuclear fusion, we could bump ourselves up to 0.7719 by the end of the 21st century. Now, boiling everything down to a single score like this makes it easy to get caught up in reaching the next milestone, but our long-term advancement on the scale also depends on our ability to deal with the side effects of generating more and more power. Right now, we are in the middle of a climate crisis because of our insatiable hunger for energy. Any new technology will come with new side effects, and our success as a civilization will depend on our ability to anticipate and solve them. So we definitely shouldn't do whatever it takes to make number go up as fast as possible, but we can still think about what we might need to do to make that happen. Most visions for reaching Type 2 involve building a megastructure of sorts around our sun to capture its radiation. The most famous of these is probably a Dyson sphere, which, as the name implies, requires surrounding our star with one giant light-absorbing machine, although it could technically involve a swarm of separate spacecraft all working in tandem. This sphere doesn't have to be solid, despite many sci-fi depictions as such, including our script editor's personal favorite, that one that caused Captain Montgomery Scott to get stuck in a transporter pattern buffer for 75 years. I also enjoyed that one. But building such a device is easier said than done. To acquire enough material, you would need off-world mining, be it the moon or asteroids, even the entire planet Mercury. But even if we do manage to build some kind of Dyson swarm, we'd still need to beam all of that power back to Earth, or wherever we were living at that time. Lucky for us, engineers are already kind of working on this. In 2023, a team from Caltech completed the first power transfer from a satellite down to Earth's surface, transmitting it in the form of microwaves. So it might take thousands of years for humanity to reach Type 2, and Type 3 is likely hundreds of thousands of years beyond that. To harness the power of the galaxy, you would need just tons of Dyson spheres around tons of stars, or a similar structure around the supermassive black hole at the center of the galaxy. A black hole emits energy in a bunch of ways. The most likely source we would capture is heat from friction, created by all of the debris swirling around the black hole in its massive accretion disk. But before we get to what an advanced civilization could do with all of that energy, why would they even want it? We're gonna do a quick ad.
Thank you for watching SciShow. We think these videos and all the great information in them should always be available for anyone who wants to watch them. And you can help keep that possible by participating in the second annual Complexly Learnathon. On November 3rd, we kicked off a celebration of learning and the free content we make here at SciShow, Crash Course, and all of Complexly, and it's live now! We had so much fun last year that we had to do it again. There are activities, videos, and live streams all month, and we have lots of opportunities for you to support our shows, including some very cool new merch. Right now, you can go to complexlylearnathon.com to check out the schedule of events.
All right, so what do you do with all of the energy from a Type 2 civilization? From our lower than Type 1 perspective, pretty much, I mean, anything they want to do? Maybe they'd run some super advanced form of AI using a Matryoshka brain, a hypothetical computer made up of nested Dyson spheres with a star in the center. And if you're thinking, did he mean to say Matryoshka? We had a long discussion about this. Or maybe they want to build a Shkadov thruster, a partial Dyson sphere that harnesses solar radiation to steer a whole solar system through the galaxy. A civilization could use such a device, which is once again entirely hypothetical, to avoid dangers like a galactic collision or a nearby supernova. Maybe this advanced civilization wants to probe the most fundamental bits of reality itself. Some of modern physics's greatest mysteries exist at the Planck length, which is 100 million trillion times smaller than a proton. Our equations simply break down when we try to look at stuff that small. Theoretically, you could study this scale with a particle accelerator, but it would have to be a lot bigger than humanity's Large Hadron Collider. And by a lot, I mean that it would need to be the size of an entire galaxy, which a Type 3-point-something civilization could actually do. If aliens ever construct such a device, human scientists could detect some of the super-duper high-energy particles it was emitting into the greater cosmos, if they just so happened to hit the Earth on their journey. And not just humans that finally managed to reach Type 1, humans now. As of the recording of this video, though, we have have not detected any Type 3 civilizations. But that's not because no one's been looking. Based on a lack of evidence, two studies published back in 2014 and 2015 concluded that Type 3 civilizations must be rare in the local universe, if not non-existent. And despite several weird light signatures found in the sky over the years, which some people proposed could turn out to be megastructures, we don't have any solid evidence of a Type 2 civilization out there either. And technically, because Kardashev's original scale got redefined, we don't even have evidence of a Type 1 civilization yet, which sounds like a massive disappointment. But a lack of evidence isn't entirely useless. One thing it highlights is the so-called Fermi paradox. If there's a high probability other intelligent life exists in the universe, why can't we find them? Maybe there's some sort of great filter that civilizations rarely get past. Because as a civilization gets access to more energy, it also gains the ability to destroy itself. Humanity gained this ability when it hit around 0.6 on the Kardashev scale. So maybe the further a civilization advances on the scale, the more likely they will destroy themselves. Maybe advanced civilizations need to learn to rein in their expansionist instincts to survive. Maybe that includes our advanced civilization. But look, energy usage, importantly, is just one way to measure a civilization's progress, and it doesn't capture everything. Over the decades, scientists have proposed a number of alternatives to the Kardashev scale to capture other forms of progress. Like perhaps some alien cultures out there have opted to live in harmony with their environment, rather than strive for ever-increasing consumption. A 2020 study proposed that we focus on the relationship between the civilization and the environment around it. This scale, which uses classes instead of types, starts with a civilization using the environment as is, as we observe animals doing, for example. That's class 0. Then at class 1, a civilization progresses to manipulate the environment around them, like how humans do now. At class 2, beings change themselves to fit their environment, using tools such as genetic modification. And finally, at class 3, the researchers envision a civilization fully integrating itself with the environment, merging its technology with living things, and maybe even creating new thinking creatures from scratch. Another proposed scale classifies a civilization based on the scale of disaster you would need to totally wipe it out, from a local spot on a single planet, like a city-state, to an entire galaxy, in which case your civilization would be essentially immortal, awaiting the heat death of the universe, assuming you managed to keep it as one big single civilization that whole time. Which I don't know how you'd do. Humanity is currently sitting on the third level of this scale, where a global disaster like a large asteroid impact could end us. And for the final example that we have time to mention in this episode, there's the Barrow scale, which proposes that instead of thinking big to measure our progress, we should think small. This scale measures a civilization's ability to manipulate smaller and smaller objects. It begins with creatures being capable of manipulating objects on the scale of themselves, and then the scale of their genes, then molecules, then atoms, nuclei, elementary particles like quarks, and then finally, the fundamental structure of space-time itself. So the Kardashev scale is just one way to describe a civilization, and despite what some tech bro might tell you, a higher number isn't necessarily better. After all, if some civilization had gone Type 3 on the Milky Way before we got here, we probably never would have happened. They probably would have wiped us out. The Kardashev scale does not take into account important aspects of civilization like social equity, environmental harmony, or disaster resilience, but it can help tell us a lot about ourselves, what we value as a civilization, and what ultra-long-term goals we want to work towards. And at the very least, it's an easy way to think about what alien civilizations might be out there that could be constructing their own scales right now, wondering, just wondering, if perhaps we're out here.